I grew up on Hammer horror movies, the late night horror hosts, and a whole bunch of monster creature features. After a while, I began to search, where did these creatures and these stories even come from? And this was before cable TV, let alone the internet. And all you had really was maybe a local bookstore, one or two small libraries to choose from. And the libraries, they had like even some of the witchcraft books, you had to be like between the ages of 16 and 18, depending on the book, which looking back on that now is pretty ridiculous. And around the 1980s, I came across an author named Montague Summers, who was a pretty weird dude. He was born in England in 1880, and not a lot is known about him. He was ordained an Anglican deacon and later converted to Catholicism. He claimed to be ordained as a priest, although that may not be true, but he did work as an English and Latin school teacher. Summers published a few poems and some articles on the occult. Then he published the first English translation of the infamous witch hunting manual, the Malleus Maleficarum. He then went on to write books on topics like witches, demonology, werewolves, and vampires. He also took an interest in Satanism, and this interest of his may have started by reading a book called La Basse, which includes a description of, according to that book's author, a real black mass that he attended. And Summers later claimed to have been involved with and even conducted a few satanic black masses himself. And people say that during his years of research, whenever he talked with somebody, he would start the conversation by saying, "Tell me something strange." Which sounds sort of romantic. Back in the 1920s, like in the US and UK, only around half the households had electricity. And I can imagine him going to the countryside to sit by candlelight with the locals to hear their stories of demons, their folklore of witchcraft. And he sips his whiskey and opens a notebook and says, "Tell me something strange." And I have most of his books, so I'd like to do a quick review of The Vampire Lore and Legend, and its former title was The Vampire in Europe. Summers writes that dead wizards, werewolves, heretics, plus other outcasts, offspring of parents themselves illegitimate, and anyone killed by a vampire can become a vampire. And he says a most prominent characteristic of the vampire is its horrid thirst for blood. By blood, it sustains and nourishes its own vitality. Blood prolongs its existence of life in death and death in life. Blood it seeks and blood it must have. In Romania, the suicide, the witch, he who trafficked in spells or led a life of cruelty and wickedness, each will certainly become a vampire after death. Also, should a hapless child die before baptized, it will become a vampire when 7 years have passed. Men who seek material gain by perjury and bear false witness will become a vampire in 6 months after death, which is a pretty specific time frame. Hungary shares with Greece and Slovakia the reputation of being a particular region that is infested by the vampire, where he is seen at his ugliest and worst. Vrykolakos, a species of ghoul or vampire which, according to belief, once popular in Greece, has the power of resuscitating the dead from their graves and sending them forth to feast on the living. And Summers writes that after the 12th century, the vampire tradition mostly died out in England, and interest began to turn to occultism. And now, of course, vampires are mostly entertainment, and that genre sells pretty well. In the end, his books on vampires, witches, and the rest were some of the early research into these subjects. So for a time there, people really believed this stuff, and I find the mythologies on all of this just so interesting. Some recent archaeological digs have found things like suspected vampires buried with sickles over their necks to prevent them from rising, or iron rods impaled through the heart going into the ground, or heavy stones placed on decapitated bodies. And Summers did have his problems, like being tried and acquitted for sexual impropriety with boys. He also advocated for bringing back witch trials, which may have just been bluster in order to gain some attention. And this may be why, when Summers died in 1948, the local Catholic rector denied a public mass for him, allowing only a private ceremony with an unmarked grave. And then in the 1980s, a few people were able to raise enough money to place a gravestone over his grave, which bears the epitaph, "Tell me strange things." And that's it. I like to talk more about monsters and creatures in future videos. And I'll definitely use a few of the books by Montague Summers and a few other authors. Thanks for watching this. Good night.
Boo.